is really cool. So first off, it's just like for us, you have the longsword fencers, and then you got the overseer, the referee with the staff. It's just like, this is why we do it today, right? Mm-hmm. And if you zoom in closely, it's pretty interesting because you can see they're wearing what looks like fencing caps to protect their heads. And it's, you see this little round thing that they have around their foreheads and temples. Mm-hmm. It's probably to protect themselves against downward blows to go into the eyes. So if you fence like this, then you often, as we know, fence the first blood. Mm-hmm. And of course, there's a danger of getting your eye poked out, but you're fine with taking small bleeding cuts to the cheeks or to the forehead. So you have this round pretzel-like thing going around the head. And there are references to fencing hats. And you can see how they appear where the chibdusak fencers are. You can see one guy is actually covering his head with his padded glove, which is really a cheeky move.
This is
obstruction, basically. But it was allowed many times in the rule sets. And I think in both Dusak on the continent and also in English single stick, which is very similar, they eventually got so tired of people doing this when they were doing flexural competitions that they forced the man to tie a handkerchief around his thigh. And then he had to hold that handkerchief with his left hand. So then he could parry with the elbow and try to lift his elbow up, but he couldn't cover.
Yeah.
So these were pretty rowdy affairs with the people. And
you got the ladies in the audience over there.
You got the ladies in the audience, and you see this young kid, he really wants to get in on the action, but his older brother's keeping him away, he really wants to fence. And then this, I love this. So you have the drummer here keeping the pace and the rhythm, so he's striking out a beat, and it's probably to make a really cool atmosphere, but also to give the fences a rhythm to keep to it. It's a way of maintaining control, most likely, because it's pretty difficult to fence with no equipment like this and trying to hit each other. So you got single rapier, very nice. You got rapier and dagger. You got the dusaks. You got staff fencing down here. You got halberds even, and then musicians.
We got some gentlemen in the backyard congregating or something.
They're congregating over something. This is the entry. And here you have some poor fella further down taking a rest. He's been beat up. There's another guy there. They made no money today. So here they're resting and taking a sword. Yeah, just like this place. Just like Roberto's place.
Just like this place.
Just like this. The fencing hall we're going down to again soon. And here, I like this, if you zoom in right in the corner, okay, you can see they have the fencing gear.
Yeah, there's the conings.
They're the conings. So they get fencing gloves, and Roberto has several of them, authentic ones like this lying down.
Yeah, I saw them downstairs.
In the basement. They got their beer and food, and if you go further up, follow my finger, up. Can you zoom in right here?
Yeah, I'm zoomed in.
Okay, you zoomed in. So at the end here are the Marksbrüder and the Federfechter seals, or their symbols, over the door. Over the door, the major German fencing fraternities, the ones who licensed fencers. So we know that Joachim Meyer was a Freifechter, and Talof was probably a Marksbrüder. So they have their symbols there. This is such an amazing, amazing plate.
Yeah.
Imagine having a fencing hall like this, and Roberto Gordi actually has one.
Yes.
Just like this, but it has antique statues along the wall as well. And then he has a museum on top. Heaven.